Well, good afternoon. I am John Wall, and I hang around the Center for Muslim Christian Understanding nowadays. I'm delighted to welcome Professor Ware this afternoon, and I can't resist doing the old geezer thing of putting this in historical perspective. And as we look, as you look at the description, we have historian of Africa and Islam, earned his PhD from the University of Pennsylvania, where he was trained in African history. 50 years ago, University of Pennsylvania had no Africanist, even let alone an African studies program.
That's right.
Where he was trained in African history, and so on. He is currently an associate professor in the Department of History at the University of Michigan. Same thing. There was a little bit of African studies at Michigan and Michigan State because there were a couple of people from the Sudan who happened to be there. But the pillar of Islamic studies in the history department at the University of Michigan was somebody by the name of Richard Mitchell. And I can remember 50 years ago, Dick and I having conversations about how do we get the history department at Michigan to be interested in African history and Islam in Africa. And now, really, this is becoming one of those fields, the history of Islam in Africa, the history of Islamic Africa, the history of West African Islam, and so on. This is one of those fields that is now in its third and fourth generation of development as a major field, so that we can come to the study of Islam in Africa, or Islam in West Africa, or West African Islam. We can come to this and think about things like visionaries. We don't have to sort of sneak in behind the door of security studies and say, oh, this will tell us a lot about ISIS, or something like that. We can, in fact, deal with it as a real subject. And Professor Ware is one of the real pioneers in the new generation of revisioning West African Islam and Islam in West Africa. Welcome here, Georgetown.
I can say I've had few introductions more auspicious than that one, given who was delivering it. And he understates his own role as a pioneer in Islamic studies more broadly, and especially in being one of the people who was constantly drawing attention to the significance of Islam in sub-Saharan Africa. I'm going to break script just to follow up on a point that he made. So it's going to require flipping through some slides to get to a map. Here we go. To illustrate the point that he made about 50 years ago, there was no African history as a historical discipline except for a few students of Melville Herskovitz, really. And my own PhD advisor at the University of Pennsylvania, Stephen Fireman, studied with Melville Herskovitz in the 50s. And certainly the study of Islam in Africa really didn't exist at all as an academic field, in large part because of a bunch of preconceived racial notions about religious identity and race really conspired to keep African Muslims invisible to Islamic studies and also simultaneously invisible to Africanist historians. People thought about Islam as something that was alien and external, even colonial in Africa. And similarly, Islamic studies scholars thought of Africa as a peripheral place, a place that didn't occupy a position of demographic or historical importance in the Muslim world. This map from my first book, The Walking Quran, and I'm not going to talk about my first book very much today, I'm talking about a book that I'm writing now, but this map from The Walking Quran actually shows just how silly it was to portray Islam and Africa as though these were mutually exclusive entities. One in six of the world's Muslims lives in sub-Saharan Africa. Africa is probably the only continent in the world that has a Muslim majority. There are more Muslims in Nigeria than there are in Egypt. There are more Muslims in Ethiopia than there are in Iraq. There's a higher percentage of Muslims in Senegal than there is in Syria. And I literally can do this all day. And if we were in my Islam in Africa class at the University of Michigan, I would go on for like most of the next hour just with that. But we ain't got that kind of time today. So I just wanted to highlight that point, that this is not, that we can no longer conceive of Africa as marginal to the story of Islam, nor Islam marginal to the story of Africa. And we've hopefully reached a point now with the book that I wrote and books like Sheikh Antababu from the University of Pennsylvania, his wonderful book, Fighting the Greater Jihad, Rudiger Sezaman's excellent book, Divine Flood, about the community, the Sufi community of Sheikh Ibrahim Yas, the book by my first PhD student, Zachary Wright, Embodied Knowledge in West African Islam. Hopefully, we've reached the point where we can now have more sophisticated conversations than just Islam is in Africa, and Africa is in Islam. So this is a talk from a second book that I'm working on. I've got about 45,000 words out of an 80,000 word manuscript finished. So you guys are getting this when we're halfway through, which means that I'm gonna leave lots of time for question and answer and for suggestions because I'm eager to hear feedback in the conceptualization and for whatever you can see of the execution of the book in this project. So please be liberal in offering constructive feedback. The basic vision of Visionaries asks us to consider the two primary meanings of the word visionary in the English language. One, original in showing the ability to think about or plan the future with great imagination and intelligence. Example, a visionary leader. Two, relating to dreams or strange experiences, especially of a religious kind, a visionary experience. But what is the relationship between dreams and visions of a religious kind, and imaginative, intelligent, transformational forms of social leadership? This, I argue, is under-theorized in the study of Islam, under-theorized in the study of Africa. So I propose in this new book to, by carefully studying dreams, visions, visionary experiences of important human agents of transformative social change, I hope to provide insight onto historical transformation in Africa and how it's related to spiritual experience. And also to shed light on what visions and dreams mean in the Islamic tradition more broadly. Does that make sense? So the book explores, in the context of West Africa, these two primary and indeed interrelated senses of the meaning of the word visionary. A person who experiences visions and dreams, trances, waking states, and a person who provides inspirational leadership. It is an examination of the relationship between extrasensory perception and transformative social action. And because of that, it should be of core interest to scholars of religion on the one hand and to historians on the other. Because it helps us understand religion as a system of meaning and social change in the real material world, if you believe that this material world is real. And of course, the dreaming visionaries of West Africa did not believe that this material world was real. They believe that lying behind this veneer of a material world that our senses perceive as real is an unseen world, a ghaib, or a realm of the batin, the hidden, that is more durable and lasting than this perishable and dying surface of a world. So from one perspective, this book might be called an intellectual history. It's the history of the idea of seeing the unseen world. But from another standpoint, this is a historical ethnography of an embodied sensory experience. Okay, because the we're talking about people, and we're going to talk about people today who had this all-encompassing experience in their flesh and blood, of having that unseen world unveiled right before their very eyes, or indeed right upon their hearts. Now I say before their very eyes, and I gave the title Visionaries, but that is not to suggest that this experience was primarily one of sight. Okay. It was also one of sound and smell, touch and taste. For African Muslim visionaries like Ahmed Ubamba, the fragrant scents of the garden, the smoke and burning sulfur of the hellfire was real. They felt it on their skins. The English language, which favors sight among its five culturally constructed senses, and they're just that, they're not universal, they're culturally constructed senses. The English language favors sight among those senses, and so it has no better word than vision to describe this kind of all-encompassing sensory experience. So one of the most important things that I investigate, especially in the introduction of the book, and I can't talk about every chapter in detail, so I'll just give you a brief piece about the introduction. One of the most important pieces that I focus on in the introduction is actually trying to explain what the nature of an extrasensory sensorium is. How does the regime of senses, touch, taste, smell, sight, function inside a dream? How does it function inside a waking vision? What does it mean to touch and to see and to taste when it's not the body, properly speaking, that is doing the touching, the seeing, and the tasting? How have classically trained West African intellectuals who are conversant with complex works of theology, and who indeed write complex works of theology, how do they then describe their own visionary experiences? One example comes from the famous North African scholar Uthman Danforio, who described, he lived at the end of the 18th century, earlier part of the 19th century. When he described his transformative visionary experiences that came with Sufi unveiling for him at the age of 36, he said that the cramp was removed from my limbs, and the veil was removed from my sight, and I could see the far like the near, and hear the near like the far, and I could reach out with my own two hands and grasp what was at great distance from me, and I could cover on my own two feet distances that a fleet horse could not cover within the span of years. And I knew my body, limb by limb, muscle by muscle, bone by bone, sinew by sinew, each according to its rank and what was entrusted to it. And I found written on my right rib by the pen of power, there is no God but God. And God bless our Lord Muhammad. And I marveled greatly at that. What kind of reorganization of the human being as an organism is posited by this kind of vision? So, I can't give you a sketch of an 80,000 word manuscript in 45 minutes. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna tell you one story that opens on to what the book does, and then I'll tell you a few other key points from the book. Because this story, more than any, helps to show the relationship between the all-encompassing visionary experience and the transformative social change. And it's a story from the life of the founder of the Tariqa Muridiya, the Murid Sufi order, Ahmed Ubamba Mbaki. Here are his dates of life. First, a little bit of context to help set up the story. Who is he? He was someone who embodied the scholarly tradition that I describe in my first book, The Walking Quran, Islamic Education, Embodied Knowledge and History in West Africa. Like many members of the clerical class in West Africa, he memorized Quran at a young age, then began studying the advanced religious sciences. But in short, he developed he majored in two primary fields, okay? He came to prefer the study of Sufism and the study of poetry to all of the other disciplines, but he wrote books in all of the disciplines, Islamic law, theology, grammar, everything. In fact, Professor Vohl was mentioning our colleague John Hunwick, who was a pioneer in the effort to study Islam in Africa. Hunwick began an effort to catalog all of the scholarly production in the Arabic language of sub-Saharan authors, and that has now reached fruition in a certain sense in the publication of a number of volumes in a series called The Arabic Literature of Africa. And the Arabic Literature of Africa actually has is an attempt to catalog that production. No single author has more entries than this one, Ahmed Ubamba. He has 200 distinct works that are cataloged in the Arabic Literature of Africa, and that is probably represents about a quarter of what he actually wrote. In those 200 distinct works, some of those are collections of as many as 200 poems, and some of those poems are as many as 5,000 lines. In the Muridiyya, they like to say that he wrote 7 tons of text. I don't know who weighed his books. But
he could get tenure.
I only had to write one. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. I don't think that I could have done 7 tons. There was a close relationship between that scholarly production and Ahmed Ubamba's visionary experiences. Okay, when he was about 30 years old, he wrote a piece of poetry praising the great Sufi saints of previous eras. The poem was called Huqal Buka'u because he was asked a question, Huqal Buka'u ala sadati namawati. Do we mourn the lordly dead? Is it right to mourn the lordly dead? And he responded with an 80-verse poem, said, indeed we mourn the lordly dead when heaven and earth did grieve for them. When heaven cried out that they're no longer walking upon the earth. When the days and the nights shed tears, we shed tears too. He was lauding the great spiritual pioneers of previous eras, and he was rewarded, so say several of his biographers, that after he finished this poem, he began seeing the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, in a first in dreams and then in waking states. And the chapter 3 of Visionaries is a chapter that's exclusively on seeing the Prophet. Not just in Ahmed Ubamba's experience, but I take more than a dozen different religious scholars, male and female, from West Africa and North Africa, and systematically go through their accounts of their visionary experiences with the Prophet Muhammad and how it was related to the social activities that they were engaged in. So he begins seeing the Prophet in waking states. And I'm going to tell a story now that's about the most famous of those visionary experiences. By the way, this is a man who founded a movement that now has more than 5.5 or 6 million disciples. And these are people that are now spread out all over the world. There are murids in every city. I gave 5 different lectures at different, at Howard, at Dar al-Hijra, at the Khadim al-Rasul Foundation of Murid Mosque. And so you can find representatives of this tradition, even in DC, you can find them everywhere. And this is their spiritual capital, the city of Touba, and that's where the story that I'm gonna tell begins. And this beautiful mosque, which is the largest mosque in sub-Saharan Africa, which can hold 50 or 60,000 worshipers on a Friday, didn't start out as such a big place. The only surviving picture of Ahmed Ubamba is him standing in front of the hut where he was kept under house arrest for the last 22 years of his life in the French colonial regime. And the mosque that he first established in Touba in 1888 looked a lot like this one. It didn't look anything like that. It was a small, humble wooden mosque that could fit a few worshipers in it at any time. Dar al-Qudus is what they call it, the House of Holiness. And in 1895, Ahmed Ubamba had a visionary experience that showed that charted the path of how you got from that small wooden mosque to this. He was making itikaf, the retreat, in the last 10 days of the month of Ramadan. What's significant about the last 10 days of the month of Ramadan in Islam? We've got students here, so I'll ask questions. It's the revelation of the Quran. Ahmed Ubamba also has his own inspiration that comes when he's commemorating the retreat that the Prophet Muhammad himself, peace be upon him, made and that preceded the revelation. And by the way, in the chapter on, in the first chapter of Visionaries, my approach is actually to discuss the way all of the different religious scholars that I study in the book, the way that they wrote about the dreams that the Prophet Muhammad himself had before revelation. So it's not just their own narrative accounts of their own visionary experiences, but it's also how they narrate and describe and understand the visionary experiences that were at the foundation of Islam itself. And that's part of the reason why I hope this book will be of interest to scholars of religion and scholars of Islam who aren't necessarily interested in African history as such. So he's there in that retreat in those last 10 days, and he has a vision. He sees the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, in a waking state, not in a dream. And previously, he had described seeing a person who usually appeared to him behind a veil of light, which is also, by the way, how Ghazali described his first visionary experiences with the Prophet. It's as though the Prophet's reality is too bright. The Nur Muhammadi is too bright for you to be able to see it right away. You have to become conditioned. You have to develop new visual capacities within the vision in order to be able to bear the light. And this vision in 1895 is the beginning of him being able to bear that light, because he doesn't see a figure veiled behind light. He doesn't see clothing that's filled with some figure that's so bright that they're just beaming gold in every direction. He sees a person that looks like I do, that looks like a person. So the Prophet, according to the many authentic narrations, and especially according to the Shifaf Qadiyyad, which is one of the texts that most West African scholars use to encounter the Prophet and to study him, his etiquette was such that he always greeted first. So he spoke and he said, "Assalamu alayka ya khadim rasul." Peace be upon you, O servant of the messenger. This is the ontological position that Ahmed Ubamba receives when he has those first visionary experiences. And it's the fruition of his own spiritual striving from the time that he was a youth. In Mu'read oral sources, they tell you that he used to make the supplication when he was a teenager, "Oh God, make me the measure of Anas ibn Malik," the Prophet's manservant, the one who clipped his nails, trimmed his hair. If he was sick, he emptied his bedpan. He wanted to provide intimate, close, practical service for the messenger of God, peace be upon him. And he was rewarded with this station, Khadim Rasul. "Peace be upon you, O servant of the messenger," now Bamba speaks. And by the way, this narration comes down primarily from two of Ahmed Ubamba's sons in oral accounts. And then it also appears in a biography that's written by a scholar called Serin Bashir Mbake, a 600 or 700 page Arabic biography of Ahmed Ubamba's life. In addition to being recorded in Wolof language poetry, written by Bamba's contemporaries. So the sources that are under examination in this study range from textual Arabic sources to textual sources in African languages using the Arabic script to oral sources in the Arab, in the Wolof language especially, but also oral sources from other languages. I'm trying to get a well-rounded picture from a number of different sources as to how these visionary experiences are talked about, not just by the people that experience them, but by the disciples, by the loving adepts that then later interpreted this tradition and carried it forward. Okay, so Bamba's response, according to the narrations, is, "Assalamu alaikum, yuha nabiyu wa rahmatullahi wa ta'ala barakatuh." Peace be upon you, O Prophet, and blessings of God and mercy. And then, because there's no veil there, Bamba sees a thing that he didn't see in previous visions. And this is where the story gets interesting. The Prophet in this vision is surrounded on all sides by crowds of people. So this has Bamba puzzled. And he says, who are these that are with you? And the response in the vision is, these are the people of Badr. They never leave my side, not even for a moment. These are the people of the Battle of Badr, the soldiers that fought in the first military conflict in Islamic history, conventionally represented as 313 in number. In a battle that had the Muslims lost it, it would have certainly meant the extinction of Islam and likely the massacre of the entire Muslim community at that time. Accounts from people who fought on the side of Mecca, but later became Muslim, said that there were 909 or 1,000 that set out that day against the 313. And in spite of their superior numbers, they were routed. And the Quran itself speaks about this, saying that it was a heavenly host that swelled the ranks of the soldiers of the Muslims on that day. So there was divine aid. Why this rhetorical importance of the people of Badr? It's because they're there to represent a sacrifice. And that'll become clear in a moment. Bamba, when he sees all of these people and is told that they're never absent from the Prophet, he immediately conceives a desire within his heart. And he says, what do I do to join their company? I too love you, and I want to be amongst those who are never absent from you. So the discussion about what leads to seeing the Prophet, and this comes largely, as I said, in chapter 3, is about largely about three things. It's about the cultivation of ethical characteristics that's going to make you somebody that the Prophet would want to see. Okay? It's also about sending abundant salawat, prayer formulas, sending blessings upon the Prophet, because authentic narrations say that if you send one blessing upon the Prophet, God sends 10 blessings on you, and this can often lead to visionary experiences. But the critical factor in conditioning the arrival of these visionary experiences where one sees the Prophet is love. Love. So he responds from a place of love. I see people that are with you all the time. I want to be with you all the time because I love you. How do I become like them? And he's told in this vision still, what you ask is going to be difficult because the ones that you see with me shed blood when they did not want to shed blood. And they had their blood spilled when they didn't want to have their blood spilled. And in the Wolof narration, the line that comes next, the conversation takes place in Arabic, but it's usually related in Wolof, so I'll give you the Wolof. What came next after that is Jamano tur darat wesuna, which means the time for spilling blood is over. It ended with them. No one can command it any longer. So you have no sacrifice that you can offer that will make you of their measure. People try to understand why the Muridiyya has developed an ethics of absolute commitment to nonviolence. Absolute commitment to nonviolence. And you're beginning now to see where that comes from. It comes from counsel that happens in a waking state directly between the Prophet and Ahmadu Bamba. And it gets deeper than that as we get further into the story. The time for spilling blood is over. So you have no sacrifice that you can offer that will make you worthy of their measure. So for someone who just expressed love, you can imagine, how are they going to feel at this moment? Crestfallen. I can't do anything to be like these. But the Prophet's generosity of spirit is one of the things that you learn about in texts like the Shifa'a Qadiyyat, and I talk about the sources in the book for how scholars in West Africa come to understand who the Prophet is. So I talk about those to some extent. And his generosity of character is one of the most important things that's stressed. So he says, but I come bearing good news. In 3 months, you will become the Qutb al-Zaman. The axial saint of your time, the pole of your era. Because no one can become the axial saint until they've reached the age of 40. Why 40, by the way? That's the age when the revelation comes. So there's a mirroring. But then he continues, he says, but this is really only a formality. If you want, I make you the Qutb beginning today. And Bamba's response, famously recorded in the oral tradition of the Muridiyah, I'll give it to you in Wolof, even though there's no Wolof speakers, just because I really like it. He says, "Lololu rafella lololu nechla wa isuma jis jis rombanafa," which means, that would be lovely, that would be beautiful, but my ambitions now surpass this. Just being the supreme Sufi of this time is no longer good enough for me. Now that I've seen that there are people that are never absent from you, my heart will not rest with less than that. So then the Prophet speaks again. Do you think you're the only one who ever loved me? All of the saints, all of the awliya in my religion love me the way that you love me. And I've appeared to them the same way that I'm appearing to you. But this thing that you ask is a thing that has never been granted before. Bamba is audacious and unrepentant in his expression of love. He just said, my ambition surpassed being the greatest saint, so now he's going to double down still further. And he says, listen, I don't know what you want from me. I've told you how much I love you. And I'm willing to pay any cost that I can pay in order to join the company of those who never leave your side even for a moment. So then comes a question. Are you certain of this? Oh yes, I'm certain. Okay. Then here are your terms. Dangay jakarlo aksanoni jamano nini jakarlo akseni nono jamano. You must go out and face your enemies in your time, the way that they face their enemies in their time. But you're forbidden from spilling so much as a single drop of blood. If you spill so much as a single drop of blood, your compact with me is broken. I'm not of you, and you are not of me. And if you are going to face your enemies in your time, the way that they face their enemies in their time, then you must leave this city that you love. Because when you came here, guided by visions of me, you prayed to God through my name that he would protect this city until the day of judgment itself, and that prayer has already been answered. So if you are going to face your enemies in your time, you must leave this city that you love. Who are Bamba's enemies in his time? This is the time of French colonization. When Bamba is born, he's born into an independent Wolof state. He moves between a couple of different kingdoms in small childhood, but by the time he's 40 years old, the Afrique Occidentale Française, the French West Africa, has been established as a colony that stretches from Senegal to Inner Africa, several hundred miles from north to south. This is the era of the white man's colonization. And that colonization, that colonial expansion, takes place with unimaginable violence. In longer versions of this, like in my Islam in Africa class, sometimes I show a slideshow of the atrocities that were committed in the creation of that French colonial state. White men in pith helmets with Africans' heads on pikes. Mutilated children. There's a meeting that's about how we respond to, going on currently, another Islamic studies meeting that's about how we respond to the current political moment. I always tell students in my Islam in Africa class, and you guys can take this for however you're going to take it, but those of us that study African history, we can never forget who the original terrorists are. That's not possible. Because at places like Omdurman in the Sudan in 1898, Muslims suffered 20,000 casualties in a single battle. Most of them occurring between 6 a.m. and 9 a.m. in the morning on a single day in December. So this was the era of a violent expansion that established an imperial state, and those were the enemies that Bamba was now being asked to face. but he was being forbidden from spilling any blood. His response would not be to take a political solution or a military solution. And that's also the reason why the Murids have this firm commitment to nonviolent action. So you back to the vision. So you must go out and face your enemies in your time the way that they face their enemies in their time, and you must leave the city of Touba that you love, and you may never see it again. And indeed, Bamba never lived in the city of Touba again after that. Why? Because that French colonial state was just about to send him into 7 years and 9 months of exile. And following that, 20 plus years of résidence surveillée, house arrest. So the vision comes to a close. That vision of the Messenger of God, alayhi salatu wasalam, and his companions fades from whatever eye it is that Bamba is seeing with. That's also one of the questions, is what is the eye that sees the vision? Is it the eye of the body? Is it the eye of the heart? Is it the eye of the mind? That's one of the conversations that I discuss in the introduction and also in the chapter on seeing the Prophet. So the vision ends, and Bamba finishes his retreat, he finishes his fast, and he packs his bags. He's been told to leave the city that he loves, so he starts packing. And he, after a few months, he goes to a town in Jolof, and another part of Senegal, to a place where he had previously established a Quran school village, a place called Mbake Bari. Mbake is his last name, so it's Ahmedou Bamba Mbake. What he did not know is that even as he had that vision, African colonial chiefs who were jealous of the social movement that Bamba represented had begun telling the French colonial state lies about him. And what would be the principal lie that they would tell if they wanted the French to come take action against Ahmedou Bamba? If you wanted to get Professor Ware arrested right now, what would you tell Donald Trump? He's plotting a jihad. It had to be that. So, irony of all ironies, a man who was sworn not to spill so much as a single drop of blood gets sent away for 7 years and 9 months for plotting an imaginary jihad. I've read colonial reports from spies who were told to infiltrate the Muridiyya movement, who said, I got close to the Sheikh, I spent time with him, I lived with him for months, I used to try to say things to provoke him in anger against the French. And all he ever said was, and this is a direct quote from one of those sources, if I were to harm so much as a scorpion, my compact with the Messenger of God would be broken. So that vision has sustained Murids through 100 years of history since then. It sustains them in American communities or in French communities when they're often persecuted immigrants from responding in anger, because they go back to that moment. They refer rhetorically and spiritually back to that moment. So Bamba packs his bags, goes to Mbake Bari, and because of these false accusations, he's arrested 5 months after the vision ends, and he's taken to San Luis, the colonial capital. There's a trial, but actually the outcome of the trial was decided before the trial ever happened. Bamba is allowed to testify on his own behalf, and what he does is he stands up in the courtroom, faces the Qibla, and prays two rakahs of protest, and he sits back down. Do your worst. So they do. They put him on a boat and send him away into exile. He told Moussa Ka, one of the most important Wolof poets of the Muridiyya movement, who wrote also following his sheikh, his teacher, tens of thousands of lines of poetry capturing the history of this movement in the Wolof language, and also praising Ahmedou Bamba in the Wolof language. And he would say that Ahmedou Bamba, who only wrote in classical Arabic, wrote a lot of praise poetry praising the Prophet. That was how he came to those visionary experiences. Moussa Ka would say that my sheikh, Ahmedou Bamba, praised his sheikh in his sheikh's language, which was Arabic. but I praise my sheikh in my sheikh's language, which was Wolof. And just as a side note, he also makes an extraordinary argument on the importance of African vernacular languages as languages of Islam. And there's a lovely book by my colleague Falun Gong at Boston University that's about the Ajami, the Arabic script African language writing of the history of the Muridiyya. Musa Ka said, he said, some will say I shouldn't write this kind of poetry in the Wolof language, that I should use the language of the Holy Quran. And he said, but I reply that whether you write in the language, the holy language of Arabic, the Wolof language, or any other language, that it's the same. Any language that you use to praise the messenger of God will find therein its innermost value. So just as a sidebar, I've actually done some verse translations of Ahmed Ubamba's poetry, his Arabic poetry. I've translated it into verse in English. And I introduced that, it's a piece that's called In Praise of the Intercessor. And I introduced that piece with a reflection on what Musa Ka's words mean for people who are trying to develop Islamic poetry in the English language. It means examining the resources of the English language in order to try to find the voice of the devotional poet. So I do encourage you all to take a look at that piece. It's published quite separately from my book. Okay. So he told Musa Ka, this amazing scholar, that when they were walking me onto that boat, one of the guards who walked me on happened to be Muslim, and it was that was the first time that I heard where they were sending me. He said Gabon. I didn't know where that was. So Bamba was sent to a place where the first few years that he was there, he was actually literally the only prisoner on an island off the coast of Gabon. Have seen The Count of Monte Cristo or read The Count of Monte Cristo? Like, think Chateau d'If, except, you know, like you're the only prisoner. Think Man in the Iron Mask. It's that kind of thing. No iron mask. I don't want to have people get the wrong impression, but you get the idea. They walked him onto the boat, and in that move, that transition into the exile, he accomplishes his most famous miracle, which is that when he's actually being sent on the boat, they confiscate the copy of Quran that he's carrying with him. And they forbid him from praying on the vessel that's carrying him away into exile. How many people know what Ahmed Ubamba does in this moment? I know Sajid knows, yeah, for sure. Yeah. And the accounts is he takes his prayer mat, he throws it over the side of the boat, and he leaps out onto the waves and prays two rak'ahs suspended on the surface of the ocean. Murid sheikhs will nowadays often say Bamba's greatest miracle is not that he prayed on the ocean, but that he prayed on time. It's not the miracle. It's the day-to-day accomplishment of the religious devotion, the cultivation of the ethical characteristics, and that's one of the things that I described as a precondition for these kind of visions. That's what made the one thing, the one thing made the other thing possible. So this boat is carrying him away, and it makes a stop at what's now the capital of Senegal. It was back then Saint-Louis in the northern part of the country. It's now the city of Dakar. Yeah. And they come ashore at Dakar before he's actually sent away for the long trip. And this also is from an account to Musa Ka, so we're no longer with his sons, but with one of his preferred disciples. He said that that day was a Thursday, and Ahmed Ubamba would always fast on Mondays and Thursdays because this was a sunnah fast, a customary fast that the Prophet, peace be upon him, was known to keep. He said that they wouldn't give him any water to break his fast at the end of the day, because of course the Muslim fast is a dehydration fast, not just a hunger fast. You don't have any liquids either. And he said that the man beat him into the holding cell that they were going to keep him in until the next day when they embarked again. So he's beaten into a tiny holding cell behind iron bars in intense heat and not given any water with which to break his fast. And he told Musa Ka, he said, on that day, on the floor of that cell, I started to ball up my fist. He said, and the Prophet came to me there, and he said, you will keep your promise to me. And when you do, I promise you the victory over these people. He said, from that moment on, he never had any doubts. He never had any hesitations. Not only was he having visionary experiences where he saw the Prophet Muhammad himself, peace be upon him, but he also saw different individual members of the people of Badr that would come to him and encourage him. You can do this. We want you among us. When Murids celebrate, there's one major celebration in the city of Touba to commemorate this exile. And the exile is not commemorating Bamba's return from 7 years and 9 months. It celebrates the day that he was sent away. Why? Because the exile was understood from within the vision and through everything that transpired thereafter, through the hundreds of thousands of times that the story was told and retold to disciples from mouth to ear as a story of celebration. Whatever difficulties and tribulations he was being exposed to, it was all designed to raise his spiritual station. It was the cost that he had to pay in order to achieve a place beyond axial sainthood. A place where his sacrifice could be positioned at least in the same conversation with the sacrifice of the very early heroes of the religion of Islam. This vision contains almost everything that you need to know about the history of the Muridiyah. And the history of the Muridiyah is the result of collective action taken over the course of more than 130 years by tens of millions of individuals living and dead. But that vision interceded into human affairs. When the unseen world was, when the seen world was peeled back and the unseen world exposed itself, it bled into the material fabric of what we think of as real history. And it began to produce social change. And indeed, the basic argument of the book is that so too Islam. That what is escaping academic scholars of the Islamic religion in their efforts to think rationally and critically about Islam is the fact that what Islam represents for traditionally educated, traditionally socialized Muslims is the eruption of the unseen world into the seen world. It's the eruption of a world that is khayru wa abqa, that is better and more lasting, into a world that's perishable and vanishing. Other scholars have different kinds of visions. When Elaju Martal, a century before, sees the Prophet Muhammad is armed and commands him to fight. Sheikh Uthman Danforio, when he sees the Prophet Muhammad and with Abdul Qadir Jilani, it's in a context in northern Nigeria where the transatlantic slave trade is causing the enslavement of Muslims by Muslims, and Uthman Danforio is given the command to fight by the same one who forbade Ahmed Bamba from shedding a single drop of blood I asked the final scholar who's considered for analysis in this text, a contemporary Jahanke scholar and a close personal friend and teacher of mine, Imam Fore Drame, about this discrepancy. How can the Prophet be giving counsel to one to not shed a single drop of blood, and he gives counsel to another to fight, and he gives counsel to a third for another thing? And this will also go into the book. He cited a series of hadiths in response. He said that there was once a man who came to the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and asked, "What is the most meritorious act of worship?" And he said, "Controlling your anger." Then there was another person that came and asked the question, same question, and said, and their response was, "Taking care of your parents." Then another person came at a different point in time and asked the same question, and the answer was jihad. And I said, "How do you reconcile the discrepancy?" He said that in an Islamic conception, prophets have to always speak the truth. And the truth of the answer depends on the one who asks and the moment in which they ask. The most meritorious act of worship for that man who came and was told to control his anger was controlling his anger. And the most meritorious act for that one who had been neglecting his parents was to take care of his parents. And the most meritorious act at the time of the Battle of Badr was fighting in the jihad. But the time for spilling blood is over. No one can command it any longer. So the basic argument of the book actually extends beyond just how we see the unseen world intervening in the trajectory of Islam as a religion, or even African history as such. I hope to actually make an intervention into how we understand the study of religion more broadly. And if we start to understand the study of religion as the study of how human beings have understood and managed relationships between the unseen world and the seen world, then maybe we can develop a definition of religious studies that isn't rooted in Christian theology, that isn't rooted in imperialist interventions, that isn't rooted in reductionist, instrumentalist, and materialist understandings of how religion functions. Because indeed, this is something that has structured how human beings build their societies from the beginning. Even atheists have to posit a relationship between that which you cannot see and that which you do. Every system of belief and every system of disbelief has to manage how human beings understand what lies beyond the prison of their senses. So this book is my humble effort to use West African Islamic materials and social histories in order to shed light on what should be a question of interest to humanity as a whole. And I'll end there.